Hi, my name is Julie Trimmingham, and I'll be reading the beginning of my short story, Bunny. When the child is born, there is light flinging from his skin. Nobody mentions this because they are too busy pushing down hard on the mother's belly and simultaneously yanking the child out from the surgical slit. The slit is white from subcutaneous fat and red from blood. A nurse keeps vacuuming liquid off. The mother can't see the child or the hole or how the doctor is manhandling her internal organs because a blue paper curtain is drawn across just under her breasts. She can't feel anything either south of that curtain. She only knows that the child is out when she hears him roar. A nurse brings the child to the mother's face so that he may receive his first kiss, and then he is whisked away to the oxygen tent. The mother is high, partly because she has been given good drugs so that she won't feel the knife in her belly, won't feel the abdominal tugging and disruptions, won't feel the layers of stitches. But mostly she is high because the child is alive. The doctors had not been optimistic about the pregnancy. She had told them, basically, to fuck off. She told them that her child was going to be fine. Now that she has been proven right, she is practically levitating, even while the doctors stuff her intestines and other things back into the hole they made. 12 years later, the child is high off cough syrup. I find a half-empty bottle of prescription liquid, apparently bought off the internet, in his underwear drawer. Why? I ask, holding the bottle in front of his face. Kyle said to, he says. Really? Then he gives me the answer he thinks I want to hear, which is also probably the true answer. I want to feel better, he says. I'm broken. What is it in math if something is neither correct nor incorrect? An unprovable theorem? I know the child has been broken by words like sticks, words like stones, but I cannot let myself believe that he is broken, as in irrevocably. If the cough syrup bottle in my hand slipped and crashed to the ground, I wouldn't see him as the shattered glass, but as the spilled syrup that could somehow pool together again and be whole. You know, I say, if you want to take drugs to feel better, you should try Zoloft, which he already takes daily. I set the cough syrup bottle down, suddenly and intensely aware of its shatterability. Knock, knock, he says. Who's there? Joke school because you're not funny, he says. When I go to kiss the top of his curly blonde head, he recoils. Don't touch me, he says, swiveling away in his gaming chair, refreshing his computer screen. He swigs red soda from a bottle, red dripping from his lips down the front of his white Tommy Hilfiger hoodie. He ignores me as he pretends to be a blue-skinned, big-boobed, gun-slinging rabbit girl in a video game. Her head is bunny, while the rest of her is girl. I'm thinking, who the fuck is Kyle? My mouth is hot and my heart is fast. What you drinkin'? I ask. Sprite with cherry. We keep a variety of fruit-flavored syrups in our cupboard. There was a time when all he'd drink was sweet blue milk. Before he can protest, I grab the cherry Sprite and chug it all down. I need to wet my words so that they will slip out in a good way. Swallowing several times gives me time to think about what I might say. Drinking it also means that he won't spill it on his keyboard, means that I'll have fewer red stains to bleach out of his sweatshirt, which is the only sweatshirt he will wear to school on the days he isn't too panicked to go to school. He gives me a look of surprise. He knows I don't like soda. When my son was newborn, his first day at home, he sang a song so piercing that even the rowdy blue jays wept. His father, my then husband, already irritated by the baby's constant suckling and shitting and attention getting, took the infant from me and went upstairs. The yowling continued, if muffled. I stayed away as long as I could, then pounded on the door until it opened. My tits were squirting, my t-shirt milk-soaked, and my child's name was flying from my mouth. In a moment, my baby was airborne, swaddling arced through the air as he was flung into my arms. My husband said this was a mistake, meaning the baby. That was the beginning of the breaking, but this is not the story I want to tell my 12-year-old. Let me tell you a story about a needle, I say to him. And that's it for now. I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you read the whole story. Thank you so much.